Hello. Well, I mean, the first question really is, the first obvious question is, why bother about Cyprus? An obscure island, barely a million, and global travel, right? Okay, we have been trapped into this troika business, but I would argue that actually Cyprus is more interesting than it looks, apart from being an island. Cyprus is a border, and this is like destiny of geography over time is much more significant sometimes than what all the rhetoric of the world says. I mean, even now, I mean, look at this. We have one of the most pro-Western governments who have been torturing to tell us that we should abandon the East. And now we are making alliance with Egypt to face another player in the East. Geography is paramount in the case of Cyprus. So once we talk about the global crisis, we have to see if Cyprus has something interesting to tell. If Cyprus is simply a district of New York or Paris or Berlin or Moscow, who borders? Now, let's see what kind of a border Cyprus is and how possibly this crisis is a crisis on the border, which may be revealing of the broader picture. Cyprus, to begin with, is a cultural border. Since the Middle Ages, it had been a border between the Orthodox Eastern world and the Catholic world, the Muslims, the Christians, etc. It never stopped being a border, internal and external. We never had one community. Of course, the Cypriots think that they are the only ones in North Ireland, but usually there is another community which is kind of living tenuously, peacefully, or kind of in conflict with somebody else. In the 20th century, our modernity has been decisively border-wise. In other words, we have been a colonized country, we claimed our independence under a very strange, peculiar image of we wanted mothers to protect us somehow. We got over the mothers, but in order to get over the mothers, we had to claim our space. In our anti-colonial discourse, we didn't really have this space-rooted thing. We had this time-rooted thing which said that we should go and find Athens, we go and find Ankara, etc. We became independent because we allied ourselves with the non-allied movement and the anti-colonial movement. Another border. Remember, we still have British bases here, we have American satellite stations watching the planet, and at the same time, we were with the others. So, again, we were there. After 74, we kind of closed borders to rebuild and see what will happen next. 1990, we kind of opened up, and then bingo. Suddenly, our banks emerges the dominant character in the economy. And from 1990, instead of this confined sector of the economy, suddenly they became the center of the flow of capital, stealing money, not in Cyprus. Broadly, I mean, the money flowing from the East to the Western side, we have to be honest, they were money stolen from these people. Oligarch money. Doesn't mean all the people were stealing the money. Progressively, Cyprus actually became a kind of respectable place where money flowed between the East and the West. Lots of money. Let me make a factor. The first two previous times that the money sector in Cyprus dominated society was a period of transition. The one was at the end of the 18th century, which provoked a huge rebellion wave for about 60 years until the economy was put under the control and the money lenders and the people who are lending the taxes were put aside. The second one was at the beginning of the 20th century. In both cases, the money lending sector opened society to the outside, but it dominated society. So this time was no different. Cyprus suddenly entered this world capitalist globalization with its banks, and nobody bothered. Since the 1940s, when we had intense class conflicts and we kind of put the economy under control, and when I say we, I mean we, the left, the right, even the British contributed by Keynesianism, Greek Cypriot, Turkish Cypriot, etc. The economy was collectivist in many ways until the 1990s. The emergence of the banking sector as a dominant sector administering keep the numbers. We are an economy of a GDP of 17 billion. The banks were administering 135 billion. The local banks were administering over 70 billion. It was an accident waiting to happen. I mean, lots of money, undercapitalized economy. Where would you find the money if the banks collapsed? Nowhere. Nobody bothered. The economy, a society in that sense, didn't bother with the economic barrier. Even though we had a mass leftist party, the whole idea of dealing with economics and class conflict, etc., was not around. It was the crisis which forced us to discover and find another language. So we have this three-border scenario. The crisis initially comes to Cyprus via the European Union, but it's mild. I mean, from 2008 until 2010. It's a mild version of the crisis. We go through a mild recession, and by 2010, there is development again. Okay, things seem to be going okay. Not so for the banks. Now, that's a very peculiar thing. You would imagine that in a society in which there is basically an even split of the left, the right, and the center among one-third, you would expect the media to be represented in some way or another. That's what my interest initially was. Peculiarly, it's like the United States, not as bad. In other words, in some way, as the crisis was pulling up, and the crisis was coming from the banks, you may say, ah, it's you telling it. No, it's not me telling it. It's the rating agency we are telling it. It's the European Union who is saying it. It's not me or it's not somebody local. Everybody, the whole fucking planet, was saying it's a banking crisis. But in Cyprus, the media, in a magical way, were fighting with some mysterious sponsors behind them, something, since 2011 to persuade us that it was a problem of the public sector. It was because you were giving too much money to the pensioners. Really? No, not really. I mean, 18 million, was it? I mean, you're talking about billions. It was because we have a lot of citizens. No, really. They were getting a lot of money. No. The big problem was, if you look at all the indexes of public finance, whether it's the public debt or the public deficit, it was no big deal. It was around the European average. The crisis came because the banks needed money. The banks were speculating. What surprise? That's their job. Their business is to sell and buy money. And if they can make more money, so much the better. So if they can control the state, and if they are risk-taking endeavors like buying Greek bonds when everybody else is selling them, can fly, bingo, you make money. If it doesn't fly, then you shift the cost to the rest of society. That's the idea. So from 2011 until 2013, we had an intense class conflict for the first time in the history of Cyprus since 1948. Suddenly, we have to talk about money. Suddenly, the Cyprus have discovered what the health spreads are, what is the deficit, what is the public debt. I remember people telling me, do I have to learn this thing? Is it necessary in my life to know about what the deficit is? And suddenly, the only answer that you could say back is, yes, you have to learn it. I mean, otherwise, you have these people lying to you in your face on television that we are having this public problem because the government is paying whatever, political immigrants. I mean, you could hear the most amazing idiocy, which statistically you could prove was a lie. So you have to tell everybody, sorry folks, you have to learn basic political economy. Where the money comes, where the money goes. I remember when I was talking a few times already, people would tell me, what are these billions? Do we have this money? Keep this in mind. So we have this intense conflict, mixed up with the fact that we had a leftist government, which, to its honor, refused to go with austerity and kept insisting that it was the bank's role. The conflict was not on an equal balance, as I said. 90% of the media were hammering the argument that it was the public's problem. Eventually, we had to get into the austerity program of the Troika, and everything was still in there. And then, what was happening? On the surface, we had this strange situation where the polls were saying that the public didn't want austerity, The Poles were saying that the public really felt that it was the bank's guilt. But at the same time, the media were managing to blame the government for just about everything. So you have this split consciousness. Under the surface, logically, something must have happened. You have 2 years of intense debate on the economy. These people, the Cypriots, if they are not idiots, they must have learned something, right? And suddenly March came, March 2013. This is the first time Cyprus made a blip on the global map somehow. Suddenly everybody heard there is a haircut of savings in Cyprus, wow, blah. Amazing time. For about a week, suddenly the control of the media collapsed. They lost control. Suddenly you could hear everybody on the radio, in the street, talking, what should we do? Maybe we should do something else. It was as if all these subterranean voices, many of them nurtured in the internet, a new voice of the left which claimed back Marxism in its own class terms, etc., suddenly became dominant for a few days, but significant few days. I would call the period between the 15th of March until the 22nd kind of a postmodern rebellion. It wasn't that the Cypriots, in their thousands, like in the times of Magarios, marching to the street. We are postmodern natives, like, you know, Indians with a radio and a computer next to them. So what really happened on from the morning that the Cypriots realized what was happening? You didn't march. It was very obvious. They are trying to pass the problems of the bank to us. They want to cut our savings. They want to tax us. Suddenly there was this huge uproar. The right wing didn't know what to do. It was in government, but I mean, even in Seoul, voters were furious. Nobody could control it. By the time it reached the parliament, it was rejected. Not even the right-wing party voters for it. Keep in mind this. They made probably a tactical mistake, but the tactical mistake is only the surface. Under the surface, the Cyprus for 2 years have been hearing this debate, it's the banks of the public. And suddenly they were having it in front of them, and they were having it in front of them with a big lie. It made them furious. It even made them more furious because small ownership is a very significant thing. It's the guarantee of equality. Owning a small thing, having something. So everything was there. So they reacted. The European Union had to change its decision, I think. I may be wrong, I stand corrected. If you have an example, I think it's the first and only time so far that the Eurogroup took a decision and it had to change. So the Cypriots succeeded. You may say, what did they succeed? Come on, they succeeded in saving their savings. Who paid? You may say, yes, but some people paid, sure. People who had over 100,000. But I don't want to sound nasty. I mean, I know that there are people who are nice, saved some money, etc. But the vast majority of the Cypriots didn't have savings of over 100,000. It's as simple as that. So in some way, it was a tax which was class-based after the rebellion. It taxed those who had more money. I know it's a sensor thing. I want to show you, you will not be able to see, so you can, you know, bear with me the description. Now, this is the major newspaper in Cyprus, selling 20,000, double the second, and probably one third of the total. 22nd of March, after the rejection, suddenly, the mysterious, invisible, no, everybody knows, no, owner of the newspaper has an article here, time of personal responsibility. Mr. Patik is a very gentleman, but here he's threatening. He's writing one paragraph at the end of his newspaper and he's saying, don't you dare, he's talking to people who have, don't you dare vote no again. I have this newspaper. No, you can check, 27 is here, up here. Okay, so now there is a small demonstration picture here. But amazing accident. They just the same day, the second newspaper which is selling the lot has the same exact message. Gentlemen, please do something. So what? Suddenly the media, you may say they didn't coordinate. Amazing, unconscious wavelength. It just brought exactly the same words in the same newspaper. Now, this was the message. The message is, let's censor March. March 2013 is like the specter of communism in the Communist Manifesto, is the specter of disorder and violation of power, which is threatening the forces of order. Every time there is a crisis since then, there is this small panic, because remember, if you don't remember, if you don't know, I have to remind you how the Cypriots managed to block the whole thing. They managed to block the whole thing because of their constitutional arrangement. The president accepted it, probably his adjustment anyway, and then when it came down here and the people reacted, the parliament could not approve of it because it's a parliamentary system. Therefore, the danger for any Troika memorandum is the same. In other words, at some point the parliament may block it. And if the parliament blocks it, what happens? So constantly since then, we are living on this fear of the rebellion of the natives. Did the Cypriots gain something apart from saving their own savings? Yeah, they gained one very simple economic thing. The recession expected by the people who imposed the haircut was 8%. It went down to 5%. The two major reasons, one is Russian tourism, because of the geopolitical position of his previous and the current government. And the second is spending money. In other words, when the lower and the middle classes saved their savings, what they did is they kept their consumer habits at least for a year. So the economy actually was better due to the rebellion than if it followed the wise advices of the economists who are suggesting it. I have to remind you about something else, at least in the secret. The people who were having this huge crisis the day that Laiki was closed are the same people who, how mysterious now, they keep saying, remember, then they were threatening everybody, don't you dare, because Laiki closed. It was a crisis, it was a huge crisis. Now they say, why didn't they close Laiki 6 months earlier? It's a stupid argument, right? You either wanted it closed 6 months earlier, so when it closed, you should be jumping up and down and being happy and not threatening everybody around. Or, like, it shouldn't have closed either in March or 6 months earlier. It's how the media works. If you don't have a counter argument, then they can do whatever they want. Fortunately, what happened after March? What happened after this explosion in March? Cypriots went back to their familiar habit. Solidarity. We have to find it among ourselves. This is the what Peter Loizos called solidarity of the village, and is still there. But every now and then there is this imbalance. The media are feeling they are kind of losing the hegemonic power which defines everything according to their own discourse. So what can we say about this experience of these natives in global terms? I have this debate with some friends of mine who say, for example, that we don't react enough. And I'm saying, we are few. If we have 500 people demonstrating in Cyprus, you're having 5,000 in Athens. It's the same thing in America. We cannot have thousands of people in the same way that other people have. So we have to be content with what we have. We are also a highly networked society. So, if we study the Cypriot reaction and the mobilization, there are two things which are interesting. The one thing is that Cypriots seem to be defending their organized society against the forces trying to individualize. If you see neoliberalism breaking up a society, you are seeing a conflict in Cyprus along those lines. Yes, the left has been the predominant force maintaining cohesion and solidarity, etc. But the right also, on its lower level, that's what it's reacting against. In other words, there is a force coming, trying to break up this collective network created for social protection since the 50s. And there is another conflict here. That's why mobilizations in Cyprus are usually geared towards achieving something. In other words, in Athens you may have a general strike. The goal is not to achieve something. Your goal is to make a statement. If the civil servants in Cyprus do a general strike, they want to achieve something. If there is a general strike in Cyprus, it must achieve something. That was actually the point in March. In other words, we want something. We want to stop this. For 3 days, the media lost control and everything was openly discussed. If you want to go back to another moment, the media lost control was when the openings of North and South opened. This was a second time. Now, how do the people react to this? What kind of art can we natives on the border create as we are defending our whatever, postmodern solidarity and trying to create meaning out of this? We lack words. What does it mean? Remember, I was humorously referring to how we enter our liberation and anti-colonial struggle by looking for mothers. We look for mother because the dominant ideology was what was imported from Greece and Turkey. Now we were suddenly confronted with a crisis. I mean, look at the neighbors. They are poor people. They are trying to solve this goddamn Cyprus problem, right? And suddenly the banks, about which they never thought that it was a huge problem, they were just there. They brought them this huge crisis, and they have to now deal with it. They simply don't need words to describe their experience. And it's not the probably the only population which needs this thing. But I think if there is something fundamental which is coming out of this, is that instead of looking only at the surface, we should look also below the surface. And if we look below the surface, I think Cypriot society is moving in a direction which it's about to give birth to something new under the surface. We will see. Last time when I was talking about this border, I said we will fight, and then we had marriage. So, maybe. Anyway, I think we are trying to give birth to something which is an answer, and we are still lacking the words. March was our first revolt in that sense, and it's a foundation stone for what will come in the future, in the sense of reclaiming our collective destiny from being administered from others.
Thank you, Andreas. Questions, comments, reactions, if any. Aline, yes.
My question is, why do you think societies reacted differently? Thank you.
Wait, ask the question.
What's the difference you think between the Greek society and the Cypriot society that made the reaction so different?
I think the two sides are very different. Greek society, it has one culture. It's not a society which we consider, for example, minorities as integral part of it. And here you have a society which has to deal with the fact that its own unity has to be defined both internally and externally. That's one dimension. Now, the third one, which is more historical, the Cypriots are defined by geography, even by the contours of their island. So they know that the people who are within are them, and that's only them, right? That makes them few. You can't win. You always lose because you are few. I mean, you can't win a war. I mean, the Greeks adopted the mythology of the past. They had the support of the West. They created a state. And every time they imagine a small empire, maybe Byzantine, maybe something. We couldn't. I mean, look at these Indians, the bankers. They had this fantasy of creating small, tiny empires. So, if you put this, then Cyprus is a society in which conflicts have to be resolved somehow after a period of confrontation in peaceful terms, even at the context of, I don't talk to you, for example. If you see how the civil war was experienced in Cyprus, in Greece they killed each other, right? In Cyprus they made different provisions, they stopped talking to each other. 1948, for example, what they simply did, the right wingers had 30 Cypriot teams in their division, the left wingers had their own division, they didn't talk to each other, they had different coffee, different beer, different brandy. So it's a society which tries to avoid violence because they are bound to lose this violence. So if you come back to the present context, the Cypriots knew that already they were an affluent society. They had something to defend. Okay? When the crisis occurred, the key thing was who is the ally to create balance. For example, the left government found allies among the trade unions, even of the right. So I think the fundamental difference between the two societies is the conflictual, maybe utopian, of the Greek society, even though it's so conflictual that I always have the glimpse of these people can dream of utopia but cannot live with it sometimes. The Cypriots, on the other hand, are a reformist, radical reforming society. There is something of the Greeks, of the Turks, in the British, in postmodern cities.
Yes.
My question is, how do you see there, like a
future? Yes, microphone is happening if you want to press the button for the microphone.
It doesn't.
Yeah, you left that microphone. Anyway, go ahead, speak up loud.
Anyway, let me talk. All right, so basically, you know, if I can summarize, you know, Cyprus is kind of looking for a new identity, let's say, for something new to happen. It once was trying to be like, you know, financial center of the Mediterranean, or Mediterranean basically, or a bridge between East and West, the financial one. So basically, you know, apparently, you know, that system collapsed. You know, it's not going to rebuild itself, and it's not going to, even if it does, it's not going to work out anymore, because there is no trust, I think, in it. Contemporary capitalism and the banking system especially. And plus, as the organizers were talking before, it's a structural crisis of capitalism, basically. So we're all waiting for something new to happen anyway. So the place of Cyprus in that new coming world, you know, in a few years it's going to be completely different in the world, basically. So what is the place of Cyprus in that emerging world, let's say?
This is the question that the Cyprus rug are asking themselves. Look at the map, okay?
Yeah.
On the east, exactly on the year, the very month we were drilling for natural gas, which changes the structure of the economy anyway. In other words, even the banks didn't collapse. The economy is moving to another state. The Middle East is transforming itself. Big transformations, we'll see how that thing settles, right? In Europe at the same time, you have another transformation of something which began like a happy kindergarten of every nation gets together and we make a big family, blah, blah, blah.
Collapse as well, yeah.
Yeah, okay, but finally, I mean, it's real politics, right? Germany dominates the club. So the others have to decide where to go. Cyprus has historical links with Russia, not simply because of the Communist Party and the Soviet Union, but even before. So Cyprus, in some way, it's linked to three different directions. So whatever happens in these three directions will determine the island. And the island is happy enough to be defined by the sea, so you don't have to divide into part of that. At the same time, it's stuck in between them. In other words, this is what I was saying before. We are few, and we are stuck in the middle of giants. As a friend of mine says, if you are a mosquito or an ant, among elephants, the only way to survive is to have the elephants keep at a distance because they're afraid of each other. Remember, we became independent not because our poor natives could figure they were independent, it was forbidden for them, so they imagined unions, but because Greece and Turkey couldn't agree among themselves. Our church, for whoever is Christian, whatever, but it's a powerful institution, became independent for the same reason. The patriarchs couldn't agree among themselves, so we became independent. If you are small, you become independent in this context. Now, if capitalism, which we thank God if it exists, collapses, obviously there must be new institutions to replace it. In other words, the idea of a big bank and then everybody is somehow illuminated by a new consciousness, I don't think, sociologically speaking, is illusionary. Every new system is built within the one which is superseded. So if capitalism, for example, was to be superseded, I think the Cypriots wouldn't really mind. And okay, they like to show off, but they're basically a collective society. In other words, they can be sucked into it. But every time, the three times I refer to 18th century, the beginning of the 20th century, now, the money sector dominated the economy. The reaction of the population, and this is not the same people, it's two centuries, has been negative. In other words, it's a society which logically would cherish other things living in such a place. The problem is how the surrounding will function. Cyprus between the East and the West will always be like that. The question is, the banks will not have the role they had in the past. So who will play the role now? And the good thing is, the people are aware. I remind you that the times of the rebellion of March, it was revealing because people were suggesting all the different scenarios. Get along from Russia, leave the European Union. Suddenly, all the sensor issues were public. And this is part of the public discourse under the surface. So, depending on what happens, Cyprus will evolve.